We've seen many ways that voltage dividers can be useful in electronic instrumentation, some directly as devices, and some as models for other systems and so forth. Here we're going to take a look at what happens when we combine two voltage dividers into a configuration called a Wheatstone bridge, or more often just a bridge circuit. Again, as a usual reminder, here's what the voltage divider looks like with two resistors, and here's the relationship between Vout and Vin, from which we get the transfer function for this very useful circuit. Okay, so I've drawn a couple of different voltage dividers here. On the left we have R1 and R2, which is just like what we've seen up to this point, and on the right we'll have R3 and Rx. Now, Rx, this one right here, could be a strain gauge or some other sensor, okay, whose value changes whenever whatever it's sensitive to changes. So like in the case of a strain gauge, when you bend a bar or something like that, then the resistance will go up or down. What we're going to do is we're actually going to compare the voltage right here with the voltage right here. That is, we're going to have the voltage divider on the left act as a reference, and the voltage divider on the right is the one that's going to change as temperature changes, force changes, light changes, or what we're going to see more immediately in this course when there's a signal from the strain gauge. When we do this, what we'd like to do is to start out where we have no difference between the two voltages. So if we call this V left and this one V right, under those circumstances, what we'd really like is V left and V right to be the same when we start. And one of the ways we do that is to make this a variable resistor. All right, so we are able to tweak that resistance until the two voltages are identical. Excuse me, and if we measure the voltage difference between the two, all we have to do is turn the knob on this variable resistor until the voltage difference goes to zero. Now this is what the configuration looks like in a more standard way of drawing it. It's drawn in this diamond shape, and we have the divider that we saw on the left and the divider that we saw on the right, and they've been combined together. If we just go backwards here a little bit, you see that this configuration takes a lot more room to draw, and therefore the conventional way of drawing it looks like this. But again, we just have two voltage dividers. That's really all it is, two voltage dividers. On the left, again, we said that we make R2 adjustable so the reference voltage can be selected. And in fact, the normal way of operating is so that the voltage at D in this drawing will be equal to the voltage at B under normal conditions. So if you have an unbent beam, then the strain gauge signal, the strain gauge resistance would be such that the voltage between D and B would be the same. So the unknown resistance we call Rx. Now, actually, it's possible to also make R3 an unknown, and in fact, this is the usual way of building a strain gauge configuration. And you do it in such a way as you put one strain gauge on top of the beam and one on the bottom of the beam, so one resistance goes up and one resistance goes down, and that gives you twice the change in resistance and a little bit more sensitivity. Okay, so here's the voltage divider on the left. This has nominally fixed resistors. Even if we adjust this one on the bottom here, once we set it up so that the signal coming out of it is equal to the voltage on the other divider, we just leave it. So those are fixed in time. So we always have the same output from that in time. So V out is the usual R2 over R1 plus R2 times whatever V in is, and V in is the battery we're using or the DC power supply. On the right, we have a situation where we want to make This is where this looks identical to before, but what we're going to do, see, we made this one on the left variable, and the one on the right, we're going to actually change the parameters here so that we've got R3 here and RX down here. All right, so we have these two voltage dividers. It shows them as having two different power supplies, but if we just go backwards in time here and look at this, you notice that you can actually run them off the same power supply. So let's go back to here again. All right, so, and the voltage out over on this side is given by RX over R3 plus RX. And so all we have to do is measure the difference between the two output voltages, and we are making good use of this circuit. All right, if we go through the math, where we just look at the two different voltage dividers, we've got the one on the left and the one on the right, and we take the difference between them, we end up with this, the expression for the output voltage of the Wheatstone Bridge. Now, a couple of things I really want to mention here. One is that this ends up being a very sensitive way of making a measurement, because by setting this up so that the voltage is equal to zero when there is no deflection to the beam, or when the, let's say we're trying to measure light level, and so when the room is dark, that means that basically starting from zero, going to some value, gives us a really nice relationship between voltage and whatever parameter we're trying to measure. But secondly, this voltage and this voltage are given by these expressions down here, times the source voltage. Neither is equal to zero. So remember, we're taking a voltage measurement between two points, neither one of which is at zero. Normally, it's the ground down here. Okay, so this is a very important thing to keep in mind. Remember, voltage, when we measure voltage, voltage is a difference. It's the voltage difference between two points in a circuit. Much of the time, we will make that measurement between ground and wherever we're interested in it. But in this case, we are making a measurement between two voltages, neither one of which is zero. Okay, and so that's basically the use of the Wheatstone Bridge. In order to measure this, we use a voltmeter, a scope, or some other device to measure the difference voltage between the two dividers. And in fact, one of the things we do when we get to operational amplifiers is to create what something's called a difference amplifier. And so it will basically amplify the difference between the two and does a really nice job. And we don't have to even worry about the fact that neither of the voltages is equal to zero. All right, there are commercial bridge circuits that are available, showing some pictures here, but usually we build our own. If you really want to measure something like this RX, you build a little circuit and put in the values that are of interest to you and measure them. So we usually build our own. And again, the output voltages are usually measured with what's called a differential or difference, also known as a difference amplifier. So more commonly known as a difference amplifier. So it takes the difference between two voltages and amplifies it. And that's the Wheatstone Bridge. It's an incredibly powerful device. If you ever look up online anything about strain gauges, I challenge you to find an article that doesn't in some way or other discuss the Wheatstone Bridge, because it's the standard way of configuring strain gauges so that the output comes out to be useful and you can make some decent measurements. There are some other uses of bridges when we have, there are some uses of voltage dividers. What we're really doing here in the case of the voltage divider, remember we have a reference on one side and a variable one on the other side. So there's this idea of the reference voltage at times. This is very important in a whole variety of circuits. And one of the chips we're going to work with in a couple of weeks is the 555 timer chip. And inside of the chip itself are three 5K resistors, which is the reason for its name. So you have a resistive divider. You notice one end is connected to ground and one is connected to the power supply. And so the voltage right here will be 1/3 of the voltage of the power supply, and the voltage right here will be 2/3 of the voltage of the power supply. and those become a reference voltage in a digital control system, which is actually represented by these devices, which we'll also learn about shortly, where we compare some voltage external to the chip to these to the 1/3 and 2/3 voltage, and these are comparator devices right here, and then use those to control a digital device called a flip-flop, which then will control what the output is doing in the circuit. So again, there is this voltage divider used as a reference inside the chip. And that's it for today, and we will see you in class.